Merry Christmas.
Thank you. Thank you very much. My name is Paul Hirsch. I'm one of the pastors here at St. Paul's, along with Pastor Mark Reichert. And we, school, church, staff, welcome you. Welcome you to this Christmas worship service. And I emphasize that to say it's a Christian worship service, that there's an awful lot of people who look at a time and event like this and say, well, it's all cute. Just look at those cute kids up there and all dolled up and all handsome and ties and wow, it's cute. It's a cute Christmas thing. And it is. It is. But these kids are the preachers tonight, preaching law and gospel, preaching what's so great about Christmas. A Savior from sin is born, and he's the one who's forgiving all of our sins and ensuring that you and I as Christians get to go to heaven for eternal life. And so while we look up and smile and say how cute they are, boy, let's pay attention to the message that they give us tonight, the message that they preach and share with us, reminding us a Savior is born. I'm on towards the top of page 3 of your service folder. Would you join with me as we read responsively? At Christmas time, our minds are filled with many enjoyable things.
But Jesus, our Christmas gift, gives us the greatest joy.
At Christmas time, we join together to sing songs of happiness.
But Jesus, our Christmas gift, is our source of happiness.
At Christmas time, we decorate our homes and offices with bright lights and candles. At Christmas time, we love to visit with friends and family.
But Jesus, our Christmas gift, is our best and dearest friend.
At Christmas time, we set up Christmas trees as a sign of living joy.
But Jesus, our Christmas gift, is always alive in our hearts.
At Christmas time, we give and receive many wonderful gifts. Let's pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, be with us this evening as we hear the beautiful story of how you sent your one and only Son into this world of darkness to be the light that would shine for all people, so that one day we may be with you in the presence of your glory in heaven. We know that without the light of Jesus, we would be lost in the darkness of sin forever. Lead us to rejoice in the good news of our salvation, and then also lead us to tell others about this child of light who came to save all mankind. Lord, let your light shine in us and through us always. Amen.
Bye.
don't imagine there is anyone here today who does not enjoy giving and receiving gifts. And I also imagine that the idea of Christmas gifts has been on everyone's mind today as well. Gifts play a big part at Christmas time. Where would all the stores be without Christmas gifts? Where would all the wrapping paper printers be without Christmas gifts? Where would all the bow and ribbon manufacturers be without Christmas gifts? What would it be like if there were no gifts at Christmas?
It's fun to get gifts, and even more fun to give them. We also give gifts many times other than just Christmas. We give gifts at birthdays, we give gifts at Easter, and we give them at weddings, too. We also give gifts for anniversaries, graduation, or other special events. Some people even give gifts for no special celebration at all.
Yes, in a way we can call them gifts.
Are they Christmas gifts?
Yes, and tonight we will take a look at them one by one as we learn about the best Christmas gift ever given.
But why are there five gifts?
To understand that, let me first tell you about the greatest Christmas gift ever given. We find this story about it right here in the Bible. From the very beginning to the very end, we hear the story about God's very special Christmas gift.
James, come help me look. The card says, this box contains the promised gift. It cannot be opened until later.
But why can't we open it?
We can't open it because it represents a gift that was coming in the future. People living in the Old Testament waited and waited for the gift, but they never got to see it. It all began when Adam and Eve lived in the beautiful Garden of Eden, but they sinned and went against God's command. Now they would die and be apart from God forever. But God wanted to bring his people back to himself, so he gave them the promise of his Christmas gift in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, when he said to them,
"And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel."
That was just the beginning of God's gift promises. Listen to what he told Abraham. To Judah,
the scepter will not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until he comes to whom it belongs.
And to Isaiah, notice how the hints of God's Christmas gift became more definite. Micah also wrote about the Christmas gift that was to come.
But when you Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel.
Yes, God gave his people many gift promises over thousands of Old Testament years. He was setting the stage. He was getting his gift ready for the exact time and place. He was planning to give his Christmas gift to the world. That's why the gift couldn't be opened. It had to wait. Can you imagine how anxious the people were to see this gift? Listen to what Paul wrote in Galatians chapter 4, verse 5.
But when the time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that he might receive the full rights of sons.
We now continue with verse 1 of hymn number 23, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel.
Thank you.
Jackson, will you open this box for me? The second box has something white inside. It seems to be made out of cloth. It almost looks like a wide white ribbon. This is the living gift. It is filled with swaddling cloths. Just after babies were born, they were washed with warm water and rubbed with salt and olive oil. Then the babies were wrapped in long strips of cloth about 4 or 5 inches wide called swaddling cloths. Usually the mothers or another helper laid the child's legs together and held their arms at their side. Then the cloths were wrapped around and around the baby's body until they looked like little mummies. They felt this would keep the baby safe and warm and help it grow strong and healthy. Mary wrapped the baby Jesus in strips of cloth too.
We read responsibly, gentlemen. Let's join together. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to his own town to register.
To her.
page 5. Again, doing some more responsive reading. Gentlemen, let's get started. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests."
Jesus is certainly the living gift. He was a living baby in Bethlehem, and he is still alive today, watching us and loving us every minute of every day.
Thank you.
after Jesus was born, Mary and Joseph moved into a shelter or home somewhere in Bethlehem. It was while they were living there that they had a most unusual visit. God decided to announce his gift to the world by putting a very special star in the sky over the house of Mary, Joseph, and Jesus. It was this star that led some wise men from the east right to where Jesus was. When these wise men, or magi, saw the baby Jesus, they knelt before him just as they would bow before a mighty king, and they gave him three very interesting and special gifts.
What were the gifts?
Let's see. Whoa, this box is heavy. Nora, Joel, come help me open it. The gifts were gold, incense, and myrrh. We hear about the Magi in Matthew chapter 2. Continue with hymn 67, What Child Is This, verses 1 and 3.
Thank you.
What wonderful gifts fit for a king, and how significant for us today that these magi are the first Gentiles to bow before their Savior. And their gifts were very expensive gifts. Gold was a precious metal, and certainly came in handy when Mary, Joseph, and Jesus had to move down to Egypt. Incense came from the trunk of a tree. It was a yellow substance that smelled when it was burned. Myrrh was a sticky substance from a thorny bush. It was used as an ointment and for embalming the dead. Isaiah mentioned these gifts when he wrote many years before Jesus was born. We now continue with our next hymn, As with Gladness Men of Old, hymn 83, verses 1, 2, and 3.
God wasn't quite finished with his gift-giving yet. The baby in the cradle brought with him a very special gift for us.
What's in the fourth gift box?
Who would like to help me open up this box? Callan and Elijah. Contains a large cloth. It is a robe made of purple cloth. This robe shows us another part of God's Christmas gift. This robe shows us why Jesus came to live with us.
This was the reason Jesus came to earth. His was a mission of preaching and teaching and leading a perfect life. His is also a mission of dying on the cross to pay for your sins and my sins. This purple robe reminds us of the pain and suffering Jesus endured just so we could go to heaven one day. Listen to what the Bible tells us about this robe in John chapter 19.
King of the Jews.
Abraham, they did. Jesus suffered on the cross in our place. He died for us that he might take away all the sins that we commit. And he did this out of his love for us. In fact, that's why God gave us the Christmas gift, because he loves us so much. John chapter 3, verse 16 speaks of this love.
For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life.
Thank you.
Let's pray again. Dearest Jesus, hear our humble prayer on this Christmas Eve. We confess that all the words we speak and sing to your glory tonight fall short of the praise we sinners owe to you for being our humble Savior. A stable was your first home, a manger your first bed. Yet for our sakes, you endured far deeper humiliation than this. For you came to bear the cross, the shame, the suffering, and even the death which we sinners deserve for our sins. We thank you for coming to share our human nature. We thank you for the peace and joy of being forgiven and for the privilege of living our lives for you. We also thank you that from the mouths of children this evening, we could hear again the precious story of your birth and rejoice again in the heavenly peace announced by the angels. We ask all these things in your name because you have also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. And even though Gavin is set up ready to go here, there's a word of thanks, a lot of words of thanks that go out. Thanks to these young Christians for all the work that they have done in sharing the gospel, God's word, with us tonight. Thank you, young Christians. Thank you to faculty. One of the gals left. All the gals are in the front seat here. Mrs. Brown is sitting up there with Mr. Brown. We'll get to Mr. Brown later, but Katie Brown was down there, and Mrs. Linda Mullen, Mrs. Kinsey Paulson, Mrs. Shannon Spreeman, Mrs. Heidi Ricks, Mrs. Sarah Nelson, and then Mr. Paulson and Mr. Brown up there, our staff, our faculty at the school. A lot of work, a lot of stuff, a lot of talents being used here tonight to give glory to God. So, how about we say thank you? Can we say a round of applause and say thank you to the kids, staff? Floor is yours, Gavin.
We have seen God's Christmas gift. We have witnessed the people waiting many years for the gift. We have seen the gift being sent to this earth. We have seen the special gifts of thankfulness that people gave to Jesus. And we have seen the forgiveness of our sins and eternal life is the blessing of, is the gift of God, planned since the beginning of time.
But there's still one box left. What's in the last box?
Good question. Why don't you come over here and help us find out? There's only a sheet of paper in this box. It says,
God gave us his Christmas gift. Now we want to share it with you.
Please open the card attached to your service folder and read what it says.